Hoy no quiero hablarles directamente de hiperinflación, hoy les traigo un audio revelador que describe lo que está por venir en términos altamente viscerales, una serie de proyecciones basadas en datos actuales y una de ellas muy inquietante. ¿Subirán tanto los precios que veremos al gobierno norteamericano entregando cheques de estímulo de hasta 25 mil dólares para mediados del 2022 y de 10 mil dólares como mínimo para finales de este mismo año? Y lo hará básicamente para evitar una revuelta nacional. Es muy irónico, y ustedes ya saben de la desaforada e irresponsable impresión de papelitos de color que aplicó Venezuela. Bueno, Estados Unidos ha venido haciendo lo mismo por décadas, pero la felicidad llegó a su fin y ahora deben decidir entre dos muertes: o cae el dólar o cae el mercado de bonos. Ahora es bueno saber quién dice esto, por qué y qué oportunidades de negocio podemos generar en medio de tal calamidad. Bueno, te lo cuento ya. En este capítulo hablaremos de lo que ya está ocurriendo mientras CNN sigue sin contártelo, de los cheques de estímulo, a dónde llegarán los precios de la comida, dónde refugiarse si aún tienes algo ahorrado, en qué invertirlo y por supuesto en proyecciones de cuándo llegará la tormenta fehacientemente. Si te gusta este contenido, ayúdanos en el super chat o únete a nuestro canal por más beneficios. Vamos a escuchar varios segmentos de audio de un analista muy cotizado en estos días, un inversor que se forjó y se abrió camino a partir de la crisis del 2008. Hablamos de Kieran Van Hyst, mejor conocido como Deso. Y a este tipo, bueno, hay que escucharlo, ¿no? Es uno de esos ratones de biblioteca financiera, básicamente, que se fija en los detalles que nadie toma en cuenta. Después del episodio de Lehman en el 2008, Deso desarrolló pues una fascinación rabiosa por la economía y una década de lectura más tarde predijo correctamente que el virus se convertiría en una pandemia. La caída del mercado en febrero, el máximo del dólar, el piso del oro en marzo y varios otros éxitos. Yo lo sigo en Twitter desde hace un buen tiempo y ciertamente ha venido acertando en muchas de estas cosas casi de manera sorprendente. Entonces arrancamos por la situación actual y qué pasa en las entrañas de la economía norteamericana. Escuchemos.
Total disaster. Well, we're not even heading towards total disaster. We're already at total disaster. There is only two options left. Either the bond market goes or the dollar dies. And we all know what is going to happen. The dollar's going to die because there's just no way in hell they can let the bond market go. The moment they announce yield curve control, that is the moment where we get certainty in the markets. Because as I said, currently it's a question. Does the dollar die or does the bond market crack? Because Jerome hasn't done anything today, the question's still left open. It's not a good question. I'm not saying it's a good question, but it's a question that's going to need answering, and it's still not answered. Yeah. Yield curve control will be an answer. Basically, that the yield will not be allowed to rise. That is the answer. But that leaves only one option, and it is that the dollars have to go down and will continue to go down, and it's not going to stop going down. You can basically see this as a gunshot victim. The bond market or the dollar, pick whichever one you want, both have been shot. You can save one by patching it up, and that's the yield curve control that's coming, but it just means that the other one's going to bleed out. And the brilliant idea that they're going to have is, well, if he loses a liter of blood a minute, if we just pump another liter of blood in his veins in that time, it's gonna live. So yeah,
that's right.
That is exactly what is gonna happen to the fucking currency. It's basically some comical cartoon character that's already been shot and bleeding out, but they put an IV into him and that is gonna save his life for a while, and then somebody walks by and shoots him again.
Básicamente, entonces, escuchamos y sacamos la conclusión de que los mercados están inquietos porque no hay certeza. La certeza la dará la Reserva Federal cuando tome una decisión. Pero de una forma u otra, de eso asegura que el valor del dólar no hará sino seguir bajando, como ya lo está haciendo, ¿no? El experto asegura que el crash lo veremos por etapas. Lo que viene a continuación este verano es una gran bonanza, muchas compras y una subida increíble del PIB. Porque bueno, todos estarán con mucho dinero en las manos y con ganas de gastarlo. Pero todo empezará a cambiar cuando cambien los ciclos de suministro. Ese audio se los voy a dejar al final porque es el audio más técnico y más largo, donde habla de cuándo llegará fehacientemente la hiperinflación y por qué. Okay, entonces lo dejamos ese al final. Seguimos.
By the third or fourth cycle, like after Christmas next year, you're going to see far more stimulus handed out to people than you can imagine. Like a $10,000 stimulus payment is in the very near future. And everyone thinks, yay, great, $10,000. No, the reason why that's in the future is because commodity prices are going to go up so far, so fast, that everyone in America is going to need more money. Right now, something like 25% or 30% of all income in America comes from the government or something. Insane number. I don't know it exactly, but it's insane anyway. And those people are going to ask daddy for more money. Daddy's going to give it because otherwise daddy's going to get a revolt. So the $10,000 stimulus is going to morph into a $25,000 stimulus check by middle of next year. And by the end of next year, you're going to see monthly $10,000 stimulus checks handed out at the minimum.
Como explicamos en nuestro video de la hiperinflación, los precios subirán sin control, ¿no? Así que la idea de un gobierno entregando dinero como locos para evitar una revolución o una revuelta cobra mucho sentido. Pero escuchemos más sobre los estímulos y de la única herramienta que le queda a la Fed: seguir imprimiendo como locos.
Because I definitely do not want to be disrespectful to the people who really need these stimulus checks because they are destitute. And I feel for them, but there's nothing I can do. There's nothing anyone can do for them. That's simply the process of hyperinflation, the currency becoming less worth less and less and less. And the first ones who are going to fail are the ones who have the least amount of capital. So, they are going to need those stimulus checks to buy food. That the problem is too big. Well, if you want to give out stimulus, that's fine. You can even just give out stimulus to people when it's justified without impacting the economy negatively. It's even already happened within American borders. I can't remember the date, but I think it was before 2008 when the oil price was very high. Alaska had a budget surplus because they got a lot of oil revenues. And rather than spend more money, they actually returned some oil revenues to the taxpayers. So everyone got around a $2,300 stimulus check, which wasn't a stimulus check. It was just literally oil revenues. But since every taxpayer got it, you can legitimately say that's a form of UBI, universal basic income. The only difference is it's labor justified because it's income from oil revenues. It's not printed by a money printer. So it's not the tools you use, it's how you use them. And the Federal Reserve can't use any tools that they have, which the only tool they have is printing money. Stop talking about the Fed having tools. The only thing they can do is print fucking money. And it's run out of steam.
Te preguntarás, pero ¿hasta cuándo puede aguantar esto? ¿Cuánto puede aguantar un país imprimiendo billetes? ¿Y qué pasará cuando el dólar, bueno, ya no sea una moneda de valor de respaldo? El mercado va a necesitar otro, ¿no? Entonces, es bueno que escuchemos esta siguiente parte.
If you want to know how long this can go on, just look at Venezuela. As long as the army chooses the side of the government, very long. Very long. Much longer than anyone is comfortable with. So it's very possible that we'll see three or four global reserve currencies in short order, which is just going to be digital systems switching from a lot of one fiat currency to a lot of another fiat currency until that one explodes. I really can't say. It could be crypto, some form of crypto. It could even be Kinesis, which is basically another gold-backed crypto system. I'm not saying this is a good thing. I'm not saying this isn't going to be total chaos, economic collapse, and basically financial Armageddon. It's here. The end is really fucking nigh. But that's just the situation we're in now. The system's not just fucked up, it's fucked up for too long. All good things must come to an end. And this is the end.
Ya está bastante contextualizado el tema, ahora hablemos de alternativas, ¿no? ¿Qué tenemos que hacer según este experto para protegernos de la hiperinflación? Pero antes, bueno, déjame hablarte de Procreator y recuerda que esta gente te enseña, ¿no? Te da todos los secretos profesionales para que abras tus canales digitales y monetices rápido y consistentemente. No esperes más, dale voz propia a tu idea o a tu producto y monetiza los contenidos. Capacítate y asesórate por verdaderos expertos en Procreator. De eso recomienda altamente protegerse en los metales preciosos o invertir en empresas mineras que trabajen con metales preciosos. Y te explica por qué, básicamente haciendo una relación que pudiéramos llamar dolorosa entre el valor del oro y la plata, en una sociedad hambrienta y sin acceso a la comida. Esto, bueno, lo voy a explicar en un próximo video. Te daré pruebas fehacientes de cómo ya los precios de la comida en el mundo, especialmente en Estados Unidos, se han incrementado de manera alarmante.
Shows that food prices rising by 17% over the course of 2020, spiking much higher than inflation for the year. What's the bottom line here? It's becoming impossibly expensive for people to eat, to put food on the table.
There's two ways you gotta look at this. On the one hand, you have to have physical gold and silver. There's no way around it. I would like to say, look, there's this amazing opportunity out there which you can just use to sell, buy everything. No, even Warren Buffett's wrong. You need gold this time. You need silver, you need something physical, because people are going to be starving because food has risen so much in currency that they can no longer afford food. They have to find some way to get food, because you can't no longer say, oh, I'm just gonna wait for food to be available again. No, people, if all your food goes away today, you have a lifespan of a week at most. There is no waiting here. If you have to sell your house to eat tonight, you will. And that's the kind of situation we're going to. And if you can offer other people currency, it's likely they won't take it because, you know, the currency is deprecating so fast and a house is a very large purchase, usually. So they would like exponentially more amounts of currency for it. And, well, that's just going to be a problem generating those currencies. So if you can give them gold or silver or something else that holds their value, but for the uninitiated, just stick with gold and silver or platinum. Platinum's fine, but most people don't want platinum because they have no experience with it. Everyone knows gold and silver. Everyone knows gold and silver is the backup. So it is the most liquid, and that's what you want. That's the only course of action left, because we are now living in a every man for himself situation. And you shouldn't even worry about the people you are ripping their heart out for their house for just a few ounces of silver, because their neighbor next door, the house you didn't buy, is going to starve.
Y antes de seguir con las recomendaciones de dónde invertir tu dinero, te quiero pasar un secreto. El último webinar de Daniel Stulin fue récord en ventas y es una herramienta necesaria para entender lo que pasa y seguir una hoja de ruta para sobrevivir financieramente. Este es el tipo de inversiones que debes hacer antes de tomar cualquier decisión con tu dinero. Otra forma de protegerse, aparte de comprar oro o plata física, será invertir en empresas que van a tener que repartir sus ganancias ante tanta demanda este mismo año y a principios del año que viene. Mineras son las primeras, ¿no? Empresas mineras.
There's still going to be companies that are going to be outrunning hyperinflation. Gold miners, silver miners, are one of them, because they literally produce the gold. So as gold goes up in demand, they're just going to receive more currency, and that eventually they're going to just pass it on to shareholders. So that's the other way to protect yourself from inflation. People need to understand that the markets aren't going to go away. There's going to be very fucky shit happening. You can just look at the Venezuelan stock market, which has gone parabolic, but it's worth nothing. And that's basically what is going to happen to most markets. they're going to crash. Of course, there's going to be a massive rotation out of non-inflation protective assets to inflation protective assets like gold miners. But after that, dollar values are starting to go through the roof, not because the companies go up, but because the dollar goes down.
También empresas de procesamiento y venta de alimentos, farmacéuticas, empresas que trabajen con chips, este tipo de elementos. Hay una empresa en especial de la cual les quiero hablar que se llama Yamana Gold. Yamana Gold es una muy buena empresa del sector. Según de eso, subirá hasta 4 veces su valor en el peor de los escenarios. Y ya hoy misma es productiva, ¿no? Y muy accesible, a solo $4.66 como valor de acción. Entonces, tengan en cuenta a esta empresa. Claro, siempre me dicen, pero ¿cómo invierto en la bolsa? No sé cómo. También hay mucha gente que me escribe, ¿dónde compro oro y plata física? En Estados Unidos es un poco más fácil, evidentemente. En otros países, bueno, hay que investigar, básicamente ir a los bancos centrales y hacer una investigación. Pero es bueno escuchar consejos, ¿no? En el tema de la bolsa, bueno, ahora como casi todo en el mundo, puedes hacerlo tú mismo usando el internet. Yo lo estoy haciendo desde hace un buen tiempo y la verdad es que siento que mi dinero no está parado en el banco perdiendo valor, está ganando valor, ¿no? Y aparte que estoy sembrando la semilla para un futuro donde veremos una crisis y donde hay oportunidades de sacar dinero en esa crisis. Entonces, yo te dejo abajo el link de la plataforma que a mí me sirve, la cual yo estoy usando y la que me parece más amigable al usuario. Pero te invito a que te informes y capacites sobre cómo hacerlo, bueno, con cierta noción y responsabilidad. Hay muchos canales en YouTube con información valiosa de cómo trabajar con este tipo de brokers y que te explican, ¿no? Para que entiendas cómo hacerlo y cuál es el mecanismo, ¿ok? Entonces yo me despido aquí, pero bueno, te pido que te quedes para que escuches lo que piensa de eso, de las acciones de tecnología como Microsoft o de la gente de ARK Innovation, de la cual hemos hablado en los dos videos anteriores, y sobre cuándo se desatará fehacientemente la hiperinflación, dado, bueno, los ciclos de suministro, la producción, uso de materias primas y de consumo. Muchas gracias y no olvides suscribirte a este canal y compartir este video.
No, tech is screwed because tech relies on junk debt. Tesla is filled with it. Tesla and ARK correlate highly with both LQD and HYG at times. So if you overlay those three charts, LQD, HYG, and let's say ARK, you can see a clear correlation. So as long as the bonds are going down, they are screwed. You're going to see everything happen, but only in stages. So initially, and that's going to happen very soon, it's going to happen this summer, there's going to be a great bonanza of buying. You're going to see spending and GDP increases like you've never seen before, because everyone will be flush with cash and everyone will be spending it. Now, the first supply cycle, when you buy a good, prices don't immediately go up. There's a stock. Goods are in stock. The goods go out of stock when, you know, enough people buy them. Now that everyone's flush with cash, that still has purchasing power. And that is the key point that everyone always seems to forget, the purchasing power of the cash. Once they spend it the first time, it still has the purchasing power because the goods it buys were produced under the previous currency spending power. Like, there are cycles to currency's purchasing power, and under the previous cycle, goods were produced at a price. So as long as the goods are in stock for that price, inflation doesn't do anything. Now, let's say the goods are bought, go out of stock, they are ordered more. Now, the supplier or the factory also has a supply of goods. Not that much, because we live in a just-in-time system, but there's always a little bit of a buffer. And that buffer was produced at a price, and it'll be sold at a price, so inflation doesn't do much. But when that producer runs out of his goods, he will need to order more raw resources to produce more. Now, that's already going to show an uptick in inflation, because there's more demand for his goods than there was previously. He can only produce so much, even with unlimited raw resources. And if the demand exceeds that supply, as it did because it ran out, the next batch is just gonna auction off for more, like the highest bidder wins. It's just when stocks are depleted, everything goes to an auction process. Now, when the raw resources run out, that is when you're gonna see real hyperinflation, because the person who mines the raw resource out of the ground cannot possibly scale up production. It's not doable, because if the metal's not in the ground, the metal's not in the ground. They're going to have to find it. If mining has happened a lot in a certain class, such as gold, you will see that grades have gone down on a lot of big mines. So the next mine that they find will also be of lower quality. So it'll take more time to get the same amount of material out of the ground. It's just a fact of reality. So the raw resources are always going to work on an auction bid process. And if there's just enough producers buying their resources, they're just going to have a lot of demand. And there can be more producers bidding for their resources, because we can just expand production capacity with more machines. But we can't expand the resources that are in the ground. So the raw resource producers will just quote an obscene price to the producer. Whichever one buys it will pay it, because if they're the only ones who can produce, they're the only ones who can get income, so that's good for their business. They will just produce at a higher cost. Now, the shops will just go for bidding process as well, because if they don't have anything in their store shelves, they can't sell anything. So that jacks up the price in that part of the chain. And instead of having basically no inflation until everyone runs out of stock, you're going to get triple inflation from the raw resource producer that quotes more, the producer that quotes more, and the shop that quotes more, because everyone along the chain has to earn money. That's when you're going to see goods really exploding price, which November this year, December this year, maybe after the Christmas season, because everyone will spend while everything is open. And if there's another scare towards the winter next year, or everyone's going to cut their spending, it's going to be bad. But as a reaction, all that's still in stock will see a discount in stores, because, you know, stores still got to sell something. That'll be around the Christmas season. And after the Christmas season, there's just no reason for anyone to spend anything, and everyone's broke.